I'm interested because we just talked about this extremely popular book of Harari, Homo Deus. As I have you here, Natasha, and I have a theologian like Miroslav, I'm interested to see what, according to the two of you, is the difference between the man God, sorry, the God-man, Jesus Christ, and the man God, which apparently, according to Harari and a few others, we can create through our technological things, and which is one of the reasons why, and maybe you can start with that, Natasha, you are also literally in the business of suspending life, and to, you know, with the idea that at a certain moment technology will be on that level that people can live much longer or even forever. And because and the question then related to this is what's the connection between our mortality and our morality?
I don't use the term immortality because I think it's a misnomer. I think it's heavily sequestered to the myths of the early proto-scientists, the Taoists. And it's also, you know, think about Sartre, no exit, you can't get out. It's, you know, you're stuck there forever. So I think of immortality as is not only a pipe dream, but it's an impossibility. Our solar system has a lifespan, our sun has a lifespan. So alternatively, I think about a limited lifespan for a person to live as long as he or she desires or is capable. And if not, then cryonics is an alternative until later medicine can catch up with the disease. But looking at this post-human era, I don't think we're there yet. I think that that has been subscribed to us by the academics in postmodernism. And I think they reached out for the post-humanist era because they had no sensibility within academics and in the mainstream about technology and the advances in artificial intelligence, artificial general intelligence, nanomedicine, nanotechnology, CRISPR, like with genetic engineering or gene therapy, et cetera, at all. So I think there was this leap. I think we're in the transhuman era, where the transhumanist era is about a human in transition to becoming something other. Now, what is that other? That could be an evolved human. It could be a human merging with artificial intelligence. It could be a human that, in my view, would become more humane. So that's how I look at it in that regard. So immortality, no, limited lifespan, yes. Redefining death, we've been doing that for eons, determining when someone dies and then we find out, oh, we could have cured that. We used to hold a mirror up to someone's nose, listen to their heart. We can, you know, bring people back to life that 100, 200 years ago, even 50 years ago, were considered dead. So that transition to becoming a post-human, but not non-biological, not some avatar, some automata out there, but a human that's in the stage of post-biological, meaning not having a shelf life, not limited by our genetic makeup.
Right. So, but if I understand this correctly, you and your husband Max, in where you live, Scottsdale, Arizona, you have this car center where, in my lay language, you freeze bodies.
Oh, okay. It's called Alcor Life Extension Foundation. My husband is CEO. I'm a member, but I don't run there. I'm an academic. I teach, et cetera. But I did do a scientific breakthrough there where I proved that two neurons in a simple animal withstand vitrification rather than freezing. Freezing is a misnomer. It's the wrong term. It's vitrification because you don't want crystallization of the cells, which will crack and... So vitrification is the methodology that's used now in cryonics for suspension. My scientific research, the scientist part of me, proved that long-term memory does exist in simple animals after cryopreservation or vitrification. It's a growing business. People will opt for it. Doctors are more interested in it now than ever. We just suspended our beloved animal companion, who is like my son. He died of old age. But the thing about cryonics, it picks up where today's medicine leaves off. Mm-hmm. It's not some science fiction dream. It's based on evidence-based science. It works. We brought back C. elegans, and that is a fact. So it's not whirly-hurly science fiction.
But just for my own imagination, there's an it's a center. And the bodies there are no longer alive, but they're also not dead.
Yeah, and that's another one of the problems with today's FDA and all the rules and regulations. You have to physically die before the team, the suspension team, which is on standby, takes you for the surgery. Mm-hmm. But we've seen people who were pronounced dead come back to life with, mm-hmm. Beating of the heart, with using different medical equipment to bring them back. So that doesn't bother me so much. But the facility, Alcor, is a large facility, has several operating rooms. It has doers there. It has neuroscientists there. It has neurosurgeons there. It's a highly reputable company, and some of our leading thought leaders mm-hmm. globally are signed up for Chronix because it is the best safety net for those who want to live a longer life.
Yeah, and because then at a certain moment when the technology is there, they can get out of this and then wonderful things happen. In your transhumanist reader, you write, transhumanism is a non-religious philosophy of life that rejects faith, worship, and emphasizes a meaningful approval to living informed by reason and science and progress.
Mm-hmm.
What do you mean?
I think that that can be taken in two different ways. Number one, it could be taken that it's agnostic or atheistic and that any type of faith is verboten. But I don't agree with that at all. I have very strong faith in spirituality. I've always been a spiritual person. I was born Episcopalian, a Christian. I went through confirmation. And as a teenager in my early life and through teenager and all through my life, I've donated more of my time helping others and volunteering for causes around the world than I have in making money. Mm-hmm. So it's like you're bad if you don't believe in God. I'm not religious, and nor do I believe in God. But that doesn't make me an evil person because I've volunteered most of my life in saving other people's lives.
Right. Fair enough. But listen, and I'm interested by the fact that you have this faith in reason, science, and progress being the fundament of our culture. To create a better society.
I think we need a better society. At the first round table, we went over good and evil and took a look at some of the problems around the world, and we heard incredible narratives about people overcoming odds and how are we going to deal with this and what is it and what does it mean. But the bottom line, in my view, is that the human mind, the introspection, the creativity, the ability to explore, mm-hmm. discover new planets, no one discovered America, it was already here, but mm-hmm. let's say Columbus, so to speak, discovered America, which he did not. But it's, we are explorers as a species, as Homo sapiens sapiens, mm-hmm. and we have the ability now, through the use of ethical technology and evidence-based science, to carve what I consider a more apt, a more intelligent, a more ethical, a more humane society, and that's the whole reason behind transhumanism. It is to extend life, to be sure, but not as we are, not as the humans that we are with our reptilian brain and our fight-or-flight instinct that brings about the in the first panel, the greed, the money-making, but I agree with that. Amazon is fine. It's not a bad guy. So, come on.
May I ask how much does it cost to actually free someone?
When I signed up in 1990, it cost $40,000.
Yeah.
And it's vitrification, so I am a neuro because I want a different body. I think that whole body prosthetics is sensible. We've seen great advances in robotics and narrow AI and haptic systems and interfacing with neurology to form robotic limbs for people who have gone to war and suffered and been injured, and they now have prosthetic legs and arms, etc. So I think that we'll be designing new bodies. I think it's going to be a major field in design and building innovation. So $40,000 when I was in the 1990s, back then, but now it's more, but things cost.
Yeah.
But you get a life insurance policy, and I pay, $100 a month in life insurance?
Rich people had been trying to live forever for a very long time, and I think giving them this kind of technology is going to be extremely dangerous.
But why do you think it's rich people?
Because,
I wasn't rich, and I'm not rich.
I don't have $40,000.
Oh, well, listen, I didn't either. Yeah. I got a life insurance policy.
And that was back in the 90s. Now, I don't know how much does it cost. I actually got admitted to Columbia University, but I didn't have the money to actually pay for my college. I didn't get a scholarship. Mm-hmm. So I'm currently, or I used to actually, work in DHL. I just carry boxes. So when I look at how some people are, you know, spending their money or the way they plan for their lives, everyone got a free choice, everything. It's their own hard-earned money. But I think there's a lot more important and very urgent problems that the world should look at. And the very first example should be starvation. When we think about, you know, solving the future
but
problems and everything.
But don't you think that transhumanism has considered that? I just got through saying I spent most of my life volunteering and helping others, including working for the Home for Incurables, feeding people on the street. So don't put words in my mouth, sir.
No.
I think it's important that we consider, we step back and consider what the larger problem is here. And I think the larger problem is, what should be our attitude towards human limits, towards human finitude? Now, there are some people who despise limits and live to transgress them. And there are other people who respect limits because they view them as not just an obstacle to certain aspirations, but as actually constitutive of the meaning of our lives. And I think that the most obvious case of a human limit without which human life would have no meaning, at least by my pre-transhumanist lights, is time. The idea of living forever seems like hell on earth to me.
I agree.
And not only because some of the people I know might live as long as I do, it's not just for that reason. But I think that you know, there is a sense in which the urgency of our values and of moral values, of our aesthetic experiences, of our religious experiences, the urgency of all this is premised on the limitation of time. And I think it's very important, you know, before we learn to be post-human or transhuman, I think we have to learn to be human. And so I am very suspicious of the transhumanist enterprise, firstly, because it's conceived and enacted by humans. And somebody has to make the judgments.
There you
the judgments,
it.
We will never transcend that kind of finitude. Transhumanism is another human project. You know, we talked about this last night. There was a 17th century Jewish philosopher who lived in Prague, and he once wrote in an essay, he began his observation, he said that the human being is a being that aspires to perfection. It's a very standard medieval formulation. But then he did something so wicked and smart, he turned the screw in again, and he said, and in a being that is defined by the aspiration to perfection, perfection itself would have to be regarded as a flaw and a shortcoming.
I agree.
And that if we don't learn to live with that, then I don't see anything but destruction.
Yeah, I think I want to echo what has just been said. I'm very ambivalent about the idea of not just posthumanism, but transhumanism as well. I kind of think that it's beautiful to be human, and kind of discovering the beauty of what it means to be human. So whatever we want to do in terms of extension of life, whatever we want to do in terms of curing the ills that befall humanity, and God knows much suffering is inflicted upon human beings by illness, by all sorts of other, in all sorts of other ways. But it would seem to me that nonetheless, the beauty of our humanity ought to be preserved. And I think great challenge before us is to say, why is it important for us to be human, to remain human? And I think you mentioned, and I think that was in your question as well, that somehow science should help us answer this question. And I have difficulty with that. I think science is an incredibly important, marvelous tool. I think technology is absolutely marvelous. Science, not just tool, but also explaining reality to us. Technology enhancing various aspects of our lives. It's absolutely fantastic. But one thing it cannot do, it cannot tell me what ought to be. It cannot tell me what I ought to want. I want something, what I desire something, but what is worth desiring? What kind of human being is worth being? That question, I think, is a fundamental to the nature of our humanity.
Then you all don't understand the philosophy of transhumanism, because the main core tenet is more humanity, more humaneness.
But let's formulate the question differently. The question would then be, what am I being frozen for?
Well,
the minute you ask that question,
you're using the wrong term.
What am I being vitrified? What am I being X'd for? Whatever you do. But that assessment of goals and purposes returns us to the traditional humanist ways of reasoning with all their strengths and weaknesses.
Do you like life?
I generally do, yeah.
Okay. Well, if you love life, if you like life, and if you love life, do you want to stop it? Do you want to end it?
Well, I love chocolate and I don't want to eat it all the time.
Well, you don't want life all the time.